Welcome to Pretty Lies and Alibis. Let's seek the truth and travel the long road to justice together. What you know, Alibiers? Happy Thursday. Almost the weekend. Big day in the trial of George Wagner. The prosecution's finished presenting their case. So just real quick, tomorrow is a holiday, Veterans Day, no court. Monday, the prosecution will submit all of their evidence, and the judge will then have what they call a Rule 29 hearing, which is where the defense can ask for an acquittal if the judge feels that the state has not provided enough evidence to convict George. If the judge denies this, we'll be back on Tuesday. So we'll see you on Tuesday. So what I've decided to do as far as the really hard to hear calls that I have not been able to listen to, my ears need a break, y'all. Okay. So I spent half the day with my AirPods like shoved in my ears to try to hear the hard stuff, like on full blast. Then when the inside of my ears get sore, I put on my Beats, and then the outside of my ears get sore. And so 2 days of wiretaps, my ears are like, uncle, uncle. So this weekend, I am planning to listen to, I'm going to pull the audio from that, pull it into an audio program and try to clean it up a whole lot and like fine tune it to where it's a little more understandable. Not sure if it'll work, but I'm going to give it a shot. If so, Monday, I'm going to recover those two conversations because they were very lengthy and we could get a full episode out of those. So that's kind of my goal. Tomorrow, we're going to go over, I have the audio from Chad Daybell's hearing today where he asked for a severance. Judge Boyce did not rule yet, but I'm going to go over that tomorrow, as well as catch up on some other cases we've been covering, Murdaugh and Delphi murders, that kind of thing. So it's nice to get this in before 11:30, and I appreciate you guys being patient this week with how late they've been getting out. So real quick, thanks to Janice, Wendy, and to Anonymous for your donations. I appreciate it so much. Big hello to everybody in WCPO9 chat. I got to hop in there today, and I appreciate you guys. Janice sent me over there. She is such a sweetheart. So, and a big shout out to Miss Chewy, aka Riri. I appreciate you, girl. All right, Doobie Brothers, song fact of the day, the band name, suggested by a friend. And as you could guess, it's a slang term for a joint. And when doing press for straight-laced radio stations back in the 70s, they come up with a really clever response as to how they got their name. So they said it actually came from the children's TV show Romper Room, which had a character called Doobie, which was a bee. Now, what's funny is let's flip this around. They were kind of considered to be like a hippie band because of that. But when their song Jesus Is Just All Right came out, they became a hit with the evangelicals because they thought it was, you know, a religious song. But actually, the Doobie Brothers said they weren't pushing any religion. They just liked the way it sounded. So I thought that was kind of funny how that all kind of ties together. All right, let's get into this testimony, wiretaps, all that today. Finally, her infamous teeth grinding on an audio recording between him and Angela. And I really was going to try to get the microphone to the speaker and let you guys hear it, but I'm going to spare you. Oh, boy. It kind of, to me, sounded like pig snorting. I don't know. It was very bizarre, but I'm going to tell you what, man, he ain't going to make no friends in his little cell. He's going to end up and like be the most unpopular. He's going to be that one bunkie nobody wants, because I'm going to tell you, I listened to it for like 10 seconds. That was enough. Poor Julia is on the stand, and I love Julia from BCI. And number one, defense attorney Parker lays into her every time, pretty much worse than anybody. And I don't know why, because she's so sweet and gentle, and he did today, and it was kind of rude, but you know. But when they're doing the teeth grinding, Julia's like looking up, biting her bottom lip, kind of like looking up really from a low angle at people. You could tell she's probably trying not to laugh, but Julia's facial expressions crack me up. And I'm going to talk about a few of them as I go through this, because I watch her. She's a trip. She needs a medal or something, right? Her and Epic Beard Dude. And yeah, so all right. So I don't understand this first witness very much. Okay. He's a forensic analyst. His name was Jonathan Prince. He does crime scene reconstruction. He's a bloodstain pattern analyst. And say they go through and he talks about Oliver's credentials and they go to admit him as an expert witness. And so the prosecution stands up and says, do you have a degree? He's like, no. So then they go to a sidebar, but he's admitted in because, you know, look, I'll be the first to say the guy has 30 something years experience and you don't always have to have a degree to be really smart and good at what you do. So I thought it was interesting that he has talked with Jake Wagner. He also reviewed tons of pages about the reports, photos, videos related to the crime scenes. So as far as crime scene one, which was Chris Sr. and Gary, he looked at the blood from the scene. And the defense asked him to determine how many people were present inside that house, which, you know, it's kind of one of those things where when they had the footprint guy up there and defense attorney Parker, I believe, was on cross-examine, he said, you can't say for sure that George wore those shoes. No, I can't. This is such a theory. But look, he's got a defense. He's entitled to one. And they do what they got to do. So they hand him a photo of the crime scene, and he starts talking about volume blood stains, which means that there's a lot of blood from a source that is replenishing and blood that was continually added to the pool. He said there are motion stains in Chris Sr.'s house that are called wipes and swipes. So a wipe is where pre-existing blood has motion. He gives an example of like paint on the floor and you move your brush through it. That's a wipe stain. A swipe pattern is a brush with paint on it and you touch a non-bloody surface with it. So that these are the predominant stains seen at Chris Sr.'s house. So he talks about a looped stain that goes over the top of a pre-existing wipe that shows a looping motion. Something was moved through the blood that was on the floor. And that, no offense to the witness, but this was really boring and kind of common sense stuff that they were drugged through the house. So defense attorney Nash asks what role the rugs in the floor played in the smear pattern. And he said the pattern looks like the white marks were there before the rugs were moved on top of them. He also said one rug is turned over and there's some sort of a transfer mark on the back of the rug and there's saturation on that with no identifiable source. So the rug was in a different position and moved after the wipe stain was created. It just goes along with Chris Sr. and Gary's bodies being drugged through the house. It grabbed onto something. There's a smear under that recliner. So the chair was moved, obviously, after the blood stain was created. He does think that Gary's body was dragged into the bedroom first. His opinion is they were both dragged feet first and they're covered with a comforter. And he says people are covered a lot just to depersonalize that person. He asked if he could determine the number of perpetrators at the scene at Chris and Gary's. And he says he can't rule out multiple offenders, but a single individual could have done everything they saw at that scene. The biggest thing for him was the lack of multiple footwear impressions overlapping in a narrow pathway from the living room into that hallway that leads into that bedroom where the bodies were found. He said nothing was disturbed in that narrow area of the home. So it tells him there was a limited number of individuals dragging the body. There were footprints in the living room and kitchen area, and it indicated travel from the bedroom to the living room. Then he's asked about the gun flash, which, as we know, Jake testified that at Kenneth's crime scene, George pulls off about a mile away from that crime scene. And then Jake waits in the car. Billy bangs on the door, opens it, goes in. He sees a flash. And then 30 seconds later, Billy's out there on their way. Now, remember, the defense in their opening statements made the comment that they will prove Jake murdered all 8 victims. So this guy has 3 videos of him firing a Glock on like a gun stand. He's in Colorado. I think this was done last week, maybe. And they show in different lights of day how bright that muzzle flash is. The first video was, you know, right at dusk or, yeah, dusk. Sorry, dusk, dawn. Yeah, one of those. Nighttime, dusk. And he made another one. It's darker. Another one is pitch dark. You see a flash. But defense attorney Nash asks, what are the odds you would see a flash from outside the trailer? And he said, not very likely. So he's shown a photo of the trailer and the blinds are closed. And he says he did not think you could see the flash outside at all anyways. And also he pointed out there was a light on in the area, which would have muted any muzzle flash. He said one person could have also done these killings since most were in bed. So we get to Cross, and it is Prosecutor Wilson up. And I'm going to tell you, he came out like a bulldog. He's very good, by the way. I really like Nash's method. He's very precise, like on top of it. I do like him. He said, one topic you teach is officer-involved critical incidents, and part of the teaching is the psychological or physiological effects people may experience when going through an event. So he hands the witness a PowerPoint used in those teachings, which are similar to his. The effects people may experience when they are killing someone, auditory exclusion. So it's essentially where your ear is constantly hearing things if you have the sense of hearing, but you're not paying attention to the sounds that are coming in your ears. Other stimuli interrupts what's coming into your ears. And it's very common in shootings. About 85% of people involved in shootings experience auditory exclusion. He also said it's unreliable to trust someone recalling the number of shots they fired or heard another person fire. And the more you shoot, the less your recollection is correct about the number of shots you heard. So then Prosecutor Wilson starts talking about tunnel vision and peripheral vision. So tunnel vision is focal length, which is about a 2 to 3 degree area that we focus on with tunnel vision. The peripheral is 120 degrees, but when shooting someone, because of the stress and the adrenaline and everything going on in your brain, you are more likely in that tunnel vision mode. So you really can't see that peripheral kind of more broad, your focus. It's almost, and Wilson said it's, Prosecutor Wilson said it's almost like looking through like the tube of toilet paper, you know, so you can imagine that. And time distortion is losing the sense of how quickly or slowly time passes during events like this. He uses, so the witness uses the example of like setting your hand on a hot stove. It's half a second, but it feels like an eternity because it hurts so bad. So you lose trauma-based distortions. It's not uncommon. Because it's, he said, it's actually very common. So what they're essentially saying is you can't necessarily trust everything that Jake testified to because he was, even though it was premeditated and Jake seems like it didn't bother him, when you're in the moment, you're killing people, you're going to have physiological and psychological reactions to what you're doing. And I thought that was very clever. He pulled that in. And so the witness said evidence found at the scene often tells the story better than the person themselves. So the prosecution shows the aerial of Chris Senior's and talks about the trajectory analysis done at the door of Chris Senior's. Remember, they use that FARO scanner, and it shows where about the area where Jake was on his stomach shooting at Chris Senior when he was in that doorway. They didn't have the FARO scanners when this witness started in his field. He did trajectory analysis with rods and lasers and doing trigonometry, which would put me out right there because me and math, we don't jive. Part of his analysis was to determine where Chris Senior was when he was shot in the doorway. And he talks about Chris Senior's injuries, and the prosecution shows the arm injury to the jury. And I thought this was really, really smart because they showed several pictures of the bodies to the jury, which I think is a way to end your case. When you're resting your case, remind that jury of the brutality to these people back here, because we've had weeks and weeks and weeks of just focusing on the Wagners. So it kind of brings them back full circle as to why we're here. So the witness calls the injury egregious, which is just extra cruel. They also talk about pseudo stippling to Chris Senior's head, specifically the wood splinters. Remember, the medical examiner testified that he had splintering in his face and his head because one of the bullets hit some wood and he was nearby. So he thinks the pseudo stippling found on Chris Sr.'s head came from the floor planks that were on that porch railing. I have the picture up here on YouTube. So on the top, I have an arrow pointing to that wood planks. And then on the bottom is a very, very close-up photo. And it's actually not all wood. It's kind of that composite wood where you have a little bit of plastic and it looks like wood, but it's not truly wood. And they show a close-up of the holes in the trailer. So two are round, and I have two arrows pointing to the two that are warped. That means at that point, the bullet is wobbling. It's possible the bullets either went through Chris Sr.'s arm, or it's possible the rounds went through the planks. And the prosecutor says, well, what about a homemade oil filter silencer? And he says, absolutely. He said there's no cast-off blood or spatter on the front of the trailer or anything like that. So his opinion was that Chris Sr. was shot on the porch first and then went into the home. Jake said in his proffer that after he shot Chris Sr., he fell into the house. The prosecutor asked if he found that consistent in his findings, and he said he's not adopting Jake's words, but the crime scene is consistent with Jake's admission. So the prosecutor says, you call the shot to the arm egregious, but you see no blood spatter. So they talk about the holes in the screen door, and it's consistent with rounds fired while that door was closed. But the prosecutor says, wait, now I'm just going to give a trigger warning before I go to this. This does show some blood spatter. I'm sorry, I kind of flipped over a little too quickly. I'll have a link in the description for all these pictures, but the guy's pretty much, he was minimizing almost the amount of blood Chris Sr. would have lost from the arm shot. So prosecutor's like, there's blood spatter on the door. The witness says, I see a spatter pattern, but I don't know if it's blood. Okay, I don't have 30-something years experience, but this screenshot does not do it justice, but it was clearly red on the screen. So the prosecutor says, you've been doing this a long time. Isn't that consistent with blood spatter? And finally, he says, yes. He says he can't say if it's cast-off splatter or linear. So cast-off is if my finger is bleeding and I fling my finger and it kind of splatters on the floor. Cast-off, I'm sorry. So the cast-off is a drip stain and that force is gravity. So the prosecutor asked, if you took a shot on the arm and you spin to get away, is that going to cause that? He said, not necessarily. Now, he is referring to the bottom left picture of those three stains that I have the arrow pointing to. He said he doesn't know if the door was open, but the shot came through the closed door. So the spatter is contained to that living room area, and it seems like Chris Sr. died around the door area. He can't say if Chris Sr. was inside or outside when he was shot, but the prosecutor says you can say he was inside the door when he was shot, when the shot was fired that caused the wood splinters. And then he says something here, the chest shot to Chris Sr. Had scorching and burning and was the gun pressed against his chest when he was shot. But the prosecutor again asked about the blood by the chair. He said, you were unaware whose blood that was. And he said, yes. The other thing about this witness is he didn't know the names of all the victims. He wasn't sure where they were shot offhand. And he didn't know how many shots they had received, which, if you're, to me, it seems like if you're testifying for the defense as an expert witness, you would know the names and how many shots they had. And you would know from a crime scene, you're supposed to be reconstructing whose blood is here and whose blood is over here, but he didn't know. So they talk about the drag marks. Chris's body was beside the recliner. It laid there long enough for the blood to pool, and it was dragged a distance, stopped, which allowed some blood to pool again, and then he was taken into the bedroom. He says he didn't test the blood to see if there was a mixture in the drag patterns, and where they intermingle, he can't say. And there is literally, so they literally put in a stipulation and they say, okay, so the blood here, they show it, and I have the picture, I'm just not going to show it. But it says, you know, we stipulate that this big pool of blood is Gary Roden's blood. And they all allow that in. And then they show that same scene to him. And he says, I can't say that that's Gary's plan. So the prosecutor asks if he ignores the fact that two shoe prints in different sizes were found in that home. And he said he didn't put that in the report. And he said he didn't have the shoes, so he can't say anything about it. Wilson asked, why did he omit that from the report, and says two different sizes is an important clue. And he agrees with that. And here's the thing. He's been called to say that supposedly one person, in his opinion, could have done these murders, although there's two different size Walmart brand shoe prints that didn't even come in. He never went to any of the crime scenes. Prosecutor points out, you forgot the victim's names. You never met with BCI. And the prosecutor says, you can't tell us how many people were involved. And he said, no. I was asked if one person could do it. And that's what I found. Could more than one person have done it? Yes. All right. So we're back to wiretaps, y'all. We finished the day with some wiretaps. This first wiretap is going to be one that I have to do this weekend. It was July 5th. It was Jake and George talking about Beth and the kids' safety. George says something to the effect of, the family has spoken. That, and I think he said that girl infiltrated, right? She did. Something about the problems we got. You screwed up. You crushed our world, Jake. And Jake says, how? George says, you destroyed us. And then there's something about Beth said. Jake says, I have not. And George says, you're always wrong. You won't listen. And Jake says, live and learn, George. And Jake says, you have issues. You have no conscience. So the recording on July 13th of 2018 is Angela and Rita, her mom. They're discussing legal representation and providing the handwriting sample. Angela's voice is very shaky in the beginning of this call. I think it's really starting to set in with Angela and George both that they're going down for this. It's just a matter of time. Like she said in one of the wiretaps yesterday, we're living on borrowed time at this point. So Angela says, hey, mom, let me tell you something. I'm trying to get us both an attorney to go with us on the 18th because somebody's mom, I didn't catch the name, said absolutely do not go in there and do anything with those people without an attorney by your side. And John absolutely can't go. And he's referred me to two or three different ones that's supposed to be really good, but they got jury trials or some court date already set up. I'm sure they did that on purpose. That guy that did your bankruptcy over there, what's his name? Do you know if he does criminal cases like that over there? And so Rita says, why? He said you could have came to him. Angela says, all we need is, his name is Henry, right? All we need is for him to go in that day. It's not like we're getting rid of anybody. We just need him to go that day. I'm going to give him a call and see. I talked to two real good attorneys, and they said we definitely need two of them. Since they gave us subpoenas for the same time and date, we're going on the same day, and they'll probably try to put us in two separate rooms. And there's a possibility that while you're there and they think you don't have an attorney, they may say, well, while you're here, why don't we just ask you a few questions or something, you know? The attorney I talked to said it may be different, but usually when they want a writing thing, the experts have a paragraph that worked like a story, you know, the fox jumped over the fence or something like that. It's a paragraph of a story like that, and they'll have you write the whole paragraph because supposedly they made the paragraph, you know, they look for certain letters and stuff that they're looking for identification, and they'll have you write the whole paragraph. And Rita said, I don't know how to write then. I'll just do the best I can. She said, I just know how to write then. I'll just do the best I can. Poor Rita. I really do feel bad for Rita, I have to say. Angela says, that's fine, Mama. I'll just talk to you about it when I get over there. Anyway, I think we got to have an attorney with us because if they arrest you or something, you can't even ask for an attorney. So that's why I'm getting two attorneys to go with us. So I'll call this McHenry guy. Okay, I love you. Bye. Recording July 15th, George and Angela talk about Newcomb family members. That would be Chris Newcomb, Rita Newcomb. So Angela says, George says, hey, Jake talked to the attorney and he's going to be there early to talk to you. If he's correct, he might be able to get it thrown out to where you don't even have to do it. And Angela says, well, that's really good. And George says, that's really good news, but there's bad news too. And Angela, her voice goes from peppy to like, so what's the bad news? George said, the bad news, he didn't have a warrant for this. I was right. They can't get no more warrants because they have nothing. And that's why they want a subpoena and went to a grand jury, because a grand jury, it don't matter if the evidence is fake or made up, and it don't matter if they got it illegally, if they lied to get it or broke the law to get it. It don't matter. So around this time, they are convening a grand jury against the Wagners. The Wagners know this, and it's really, they're trying, George is really trying to convince his mother and himself in this phone call that this is all going to be okay, and this really isn't going to happen. He said the grand jury, they can still use that evidence. With a warrant, they can't. And if their officer wants to go in some county, I couldn't tell, he was speaking banjo, and tell them we're a bunch of horrible, evil people, they can take their word on it and send that based on that officer's word. The court be lying. Angela said, except that's where they got mom. That's where they pulled mom in them, because they know they can't just take and do it against us with everything they've done to us. And they got to have another person to come in and witness. That's why he told mom, mom had to testify for them. And George said that's the only reason, because they know we'll appeal it and have it switched to a grand jury in Pike County, which means that all this regular family or relatives, murdered their family. So I kind of think he was implicating like the Roden family or the Manley family. Angela says, right. And George says, when you get an appeal someplace else and somebody who's not with them is going to believe their lies, when you prove that they're lying, then he's going to have somebody other than the Manleys. Angela says, no, they're going to have to prove, they're going to have to show evidence. And her and George are just talking over each other. It's just banjo soup. And so finally, Angela's like, whoa, look, they don't have to show evidence if they got one witness. George says, yeah, mom, but that's the thing. You're probably going to have this attorney. He's more than likely going to have to subpoena Rick and Edie and Owen and Margie and Pam and Joe and everybody that knows us for our character to say how we are, and everyone we can get. If we have to subpoena them, we have to subpoena them. And Angela says, well, we got to do what you got to do, George. George says, I'm sorry, give me Chris in there. Angela says, listen, let me tell you something. This is what's been going through the grapevine. I have been collecting info on them. They don't have anything. They don't have witnesses. They don't have nothing. Mom is what they're going to try and use as a witness. They're going to use a family member. George says, yep, we need to get Tammy in there too. And Angela says, yeah, she loves us. George said, yeah, that's why I said, I'm sorry, you're going to subpoena Eddie if you have to. Angela says, yeah. And then they shoot some names back and forth. Angela says, well, maybe it won't go that far. If they don't get this witness, they ain't going to get nothing, you know, right? George says, I know they ain't got nothing. Angela says, what I'm saying is mom won't be a witness. I don't know why they think mom's going to be a witness. And George said, this attorney said that she is to tell the truth in a court of law and nothing but the truth. She cannot lie. So if she goes in there and says she's my daughter and that's the truth, they can't make her lie because that's against the law. I think he's getting confused with like spousal privilege, which totally doesn't apply in this case, but maybe I misunderstood because it was bum bada bum banjo. She doesn't have to testify against you, but she has to testify on the stand. And Angela said, right. He said the same thing. If she doesn't understand, they have to let her confer with the attorney and they have to give her a recess and let her come in the hallway and talk to her attorney. George says, I love you, mom, but if we do get convicted or indicted or charged or whatever, and we each get our own attorney instead of only one, that way you got five people, five attorneys working together, five attorneys going for Ohio instead of one. Angela says, I think when they find out they don't have anything, you're not just in front of hiding. When they find out they have nothing, I don't think they'll go any farther. So she said, what's the grand jury going to say? You want us to keep going when everything keeps coming up to nothing? That's what it's going to come down to. What did this attorney say about the media? And George said he didn't say anything about the media yet. He's still doing research. You may need to contact them. Anyways, he said if he can go in and argue that for a couple of days, then you don't have to take the handwritten test. He said it might be more than 1,000 if he goes 2, 3, 4, 5 hours. And let's see. He said, well, Granny told me today she would pay as long as they got rid of it. But the thing of it is here's what I'm worried about too. Angela says, I wonder if this gets out. I'm wondering if the media will be there. I think she's talking about the grand jury. So, of course, they would have been there. George says they might. Angela said, that's another reason I don't want Chris there. Talking about her half-brother, Chris Newcomb. Angela says, well, anyways, if I get a chance to go back up there, wait, I can't go up there now. They're potty training Colby. George says, why does that matter? And Angela said, because they can't be potty training him with Bullvine and Sophie there because he won't pay attention or something. He can't even come outside to play when they're trying to potty train him. And George says, you're kidding me. That's not how you potty train a kid. And Angela said, that's what Randa said, George. Randa's doing it this way, or mama. Angela says, Randa. George says, that's stupid. That's not how you potty train a kid. And Angela said, no, it isn't, but she doesn't want to get up off the couch when her and Chris are watching movies. George said, that's why she's doing it this way. Lazy little, I couldn't hear the word, but I saw Julia on the stand's reaction. It must have been a bad one. Now it's time for our paid sponsor of the week, Everly Well. This year, you can prioritize what matters most when you share the gift of health from Everly Well. Choose from at-home lab tests like food sensitivity, women's health, or men's health, or vitamins and supplements because love and health are all you need. Everly Well is digital healthcare designed for you with personalized results and accessible tools for long-term health. With over 30 at-home lab tests and high-quality vitamins and supplements, you'll be able to find the perfect test for you or your loved one. The women's health, food sensitivity, and celiac disease screening tests are only a few of the options. Here's how it works. Everly Well ships products straight to you or your loved one with everything needed in one package. If you ordered an at-home lab test, the sample can be simply collected at home and shipped back to a certified lab in the prepaid envelope included with the test. Digital, physician-reviewed results are sent straight to your preferred device in just days. If you ordered vitamins and supplements, you can start adding them to your daily routine right away. It's so simple. Over 1 million people have trusted Everly Well to support their health and wellness goals, and now you can help your loved ones do the same. I took the food sensitivity test, which measures your body's immune response to 96 foods to help guide you on what types of food to prioritize in a two-part elimination diet. The gift of health has never been so easy to share than it is this holiday. For listeners of Pretty Lies and Alibis, Everly Well is offering a discount of 20% off an at-home lab test at everlywell.com/whattheworld. That's everlywell.com/whattheworld for 20% off your next at-home lab test. That's everlywell.com/whattheworld. So George says, listen, you need to go up there and get Mama in her truck down there and tell her they do not need to go. Angela says, you know what'll happen? They'll catch him in the parking lot. And George starts yelling, something about if they try to do something with Chris, I can't make it out. It's unconstitutional. It's illegal. Something about a conversation with someone Chris doesn't know is an agent. They can use that. In other words, if Chris starts, look, we know Chris talks. We saw him on the stand. And apparently he talks a lot. So they're worried about that. And so he needs to look at them and say, leave. I'm not talking to you at all. They're not to speak to anyone about us or that case, period. You hear me? And Angela says, yeah, I know that, George. I keep telling Mom to be quiet and not say anything. George says, it's not her mom, it's Chris. Every time they come, he tries to talk to them. And Angela says, oh, I know, he got to him. Randa does too. Randa goes and she runs after them. And George says, from here on out, they're not speaking to them. Angela says, this is what you're going to have to do. You're going to have to tell them, and then George interrupts. I will take care of it when I get there, because if they don't stop, they're going to get drug into this. And Angela says, Mom's already drug in. I wouldn't be surprised if Mom's not drug in because of all this. The things she said to them, and George said, yeah, because she keeps involving them. And Angela says, yep, I know she does. And if Chris doesn't stop, they're going to drag him into. And Angela says, oh, yeah, I know. So Angela says, okay, we'll talk when you get home. Can you talk to him about all that? And I love you too. And I'll see if I can talk to her. Hopefully I'll have to wait until you get home though. George says, I'm going to call and tell her right now. And Angela said, wait, let me bring her down here this minute, okay? Then she says, let me feed Big V lunch because I don't want to hear whining crying about wanting to go up there. George says, I love you. Love you. Bye. Lord have mercy. Okay, can we just talk about the fact last night that I dreamed I was trapped on the Wagner property and I was plotting my escape and I was going to dig a tunnel through all that property to the road? They've infiltrated my dreams. That's like my time, y'all. And there's Angela Wagner watching me around the corner. It's like nightmare. Worse than a horror movie. I ain't kidding y'all. I was like, I know what happens when you live here. All right, July 20th, George and Angela discussed legal representation. So George says, well, maybe it won't go that far because they ain't getting nothing. You know that, right? Angela said, well, one thing, mom won't be a witness. I don't know why they think mom's going to be a witness. Granny told me today that she was not. So, okay, this is literally like the nicest that we've heard George yet, this next part of the conversation. And I noticed Julia looking over at the jury at certain times when things were said. So Angela's, this next call, Angela says, hello. And George is asking why him and Jake need to go to the lawyer's office. Angela said he needs to talk to you and Jake and your dad. Your dad talked to him a little bit today, and he's going to go over a bunch of stuff and tell you what to do and which one needs more help. I think maybe this is when they're going to give their foot impressions in that foam over at BCI. And George says, I'm sorry, but I'm going to tell you this. Whoever the best attorney is going to be yours. And Angela said, Jake said that too. And what really struck me with this is George kept saying, I'm sorry. Before he would even say anything to her, I'm sorry. But George says, I'm sorry. I know this is when I noticed Julia looking over. He says, you're the only one who can manage to take care of the kids by themselves. The rest of us can screw ourselves. Angela said, it doesn't matter. You need to go talk to him. And George says, I'll talk to him, but I'm sorry. Whichever one is going to get the best attorney is going to be your attorney. I don't care what my grandmother says. It's going to be yours. Angela said, that's what she said. You guys have got to check out the link in the description for the pictures if you're not on Twitter. So Angela says, George says, I'm sorry. I'll go in and I'll do it with that one if I have to. I don't care. In other words, he's going to go in and confront his grandma if she doesn't agree that Angela gets the best attorney. And Angela is still trying to say, that's what she said. George said, what? And Angela said, that's what she said. Also, that's what your dad said. The best attorney is what takes 100% to get somebody out of there. It's going to be what goes to you, mom. Angela says, George, honey, watch what you're doing. Everything will be okay. And George says, all right, love you. Angela says, love you too. Next recording, July 20th, 2018. This is about 4 months before they're arrested. So, you know, time's a ticking. This is Jake to Angela. Angela gives Jake advice from an attorney. Angela says, are you all right? Jake says, I'm fine. Angela said he wanted me to give you this advice until he gets to talk to you. Don't talk to anybody. Don't answer no questions and remain calm. Don't you eat. You probably got bed bugs, so remain calm. Watch what you say. Don't get angry. Control yourself. And Jake said, okay, I don't know what she meant by bed bugs, like literal bed bugs, or like, is he ants in his pants? I don't know. She said, you probably got bed bugs. So remain calm. Look, if I have bed bugs, I would be anything but calm. So Angela says, probably stressful, but absolutely just control yourself. Jake says, okie dokie. And Angela says, hey, tell George that. So this is on July 24th, George and Angela. This is where George talks about moving. George said, I'm sorry. I want to own a farm somewhere out west where I can still make a living and me and Jake can get a two-story with you and the kids and whoever else wants to join. We could have a nice, peaceful life without all the crap and the drama from everyone. Angela says, well, whoever comes to stay with us, George, I got to say something. I don't care who comes and stays with us. I like people, but they're going to have to understand Sophie and Vine. She don't understand people, y'all. We cannot move somebody in or move someone around there who expects them to be something they're not and treat them awful. And George said, are you talking about Josie? Remember, Josie is this girl that he met, I think, in Alaska, and he was going to move in with her. It seemed like it was serious. So I'm guessing at this point they're still talking. George says she understands what they've been through. She understands they're going to need a lot of extra help and that it's hard on them and they don't understand it all. She understands my predicament because she's lived it herself. I hope he's talking about being a single dad, not, yeah, I'm sure, yeah, being a single dad. Because I thought, well, what predicament? Well, Angela says, well, George, I hate to say this, but you know, and this is that manipulation coming in. Okay, just listen. Even though, like, I don't feel sorry for George, but she says, well, George, I hate to say this, but you know that other person that moved in with us a little bit ago? She said she understood stuff, and I don't think she did. So, look, I mean, George knows the walls are closing in. This is a pipe dream, and you can kind of tell that Angela half is involved in the conversation. Maybe she's just appeasing George to keep him calm. I don't know, but we know she was worried about George freaking out. But still, like, okay, so George was in on this. He was inside the houses when people were murdered. I have like less than zero sympathy for him, but I do think I've seen a lot of people online lately who are sympathizing a bit more with George, and sometimes that can happen in trials when you see somebody who, look, he had an opportunity to stop all this. That's like first and foremost, but he also had an opportunity to shoot Chris Sr. and he didn't, and he couldn't. So I think if anybody out of the Wagners had like a teeny, teeny, teeny tiny amount of heart, it was George. So we go to the text from July 28th. George to Josie, he sends a text and it's really brief about his family. He said, "And are you okay with the fact that I'm really close with my family? I know it's weird for most people, but family is all we really have in life." And that was it. So he was still talking to her as of almost August. August 8th, George and Jake talk about the Winter Soldier face mask. This is in the car or in the truck. And BCI asked them about that face mask. And Jake says, "Yeah. And at the time, you had a motorcycle and that's what you wore." And George said something about, "Why is it still in my house and in a bag? And they didn't take it." And then he says, "Them SOBs can go to the hot place," in uncertain terms. So, recording August 11th, this is about 5 minutes after midnight, and George talks about a bug detector. George said, "I ordered my mother's freaking bug detector." And Angela said, "Did he tell you? They said we had one of them too that picks up video cameras." George said, "Bunch of bull crap. I had a bug detector." Angela said, "It didn't pick up video cameras, George." He said, "No, it picks up listening devices in cases, except for when law enforcement was freaking stalking your house." And Angela said, "It picked up bugs." George said, "Tracking devices, anything for a listening device. It can pick up certain surveillance cameras." And Angela says, "Oh, it did not. Oh, gosh, that's about as dumb as your tattoo, George. Why are they talking about your tattoo, but they haven't asked about your dad's crazy thing? Remember, Billy got the scorpion on his hand." And here comes the August 13th recording of the grinding of the teeth. I should have queued that up for y'all. Yeah, I'm about to do it. I'm gonna see if I can find it real quick before I'm reading this. I sent it to Biggie at the timestamp. So, okay. So on this recording, Billy says, "Hey, what you need?" Angela says, "Nope, I'm sorry, wrong one." Listen. Y'all, that thing that sounds like a pig snorting, that is Billy grinding his teeth. So in this call on August 13th, Billy asked Jake about a picture, and Billy kind of sounds nervous. It's not that really loud, you know, just obnoxious voice that we heard with BCI. He says, "You got a pic of that gun they were going on about? You got one anywhere?" And Jake says, "No." They texted one to George, "Hey, mom." And Billy says, "Just text me a picture of it. I need to see it." And Jake says, "Hold on." Like he yells at his dad. So Jake tells Angela, "Does George still have that picture BCI texted of that gun?" Grind, grind, grind. Literally all Julia from BCI was sitting in her chair and she was like, her head was down and her face was getting red and she was kind of biting her lower lip and then she would look up. And oh man, you could tell she was trying not to laugh. But then there were times yesterday, like I think she got a little emotional listening to some of the stuff. Maybe when it came to the kids. I like Julia. She's awesome. I wish she had that buy me a coffee. I'd buy her like 100 of them. So Jake says, mom will try to see if she can get it, but she doesn't know if she's got it or not. It might be on one of her phones. Billy says, all right, but listen, if you got it, text it to me. It's important. And Jake says, if we have it, we will. And Billy says, you should have it. Hurry up. All right, bye. So this is the same night about 20 minutes later. Billy says, hey, what you need? And Angela says, I want to make sure you got that. And Billy says, I ain't got it yet. And Angela says, well, I sent it. George texted me and I sent it right over. Billy says, let me check. I'll call you back. And Angela says, where are you? And Billy said, I'm in his parking lot. She says, you haven't went in and talked to him yet? And Billy said, no, I'm early. Angela says, oh, okay. Hey, listen, on your way back through, do you have $15? Now, here's the thing. You could tell this wasn't supposed to be played because Canepa's like, can you turn that off? And then Julia's on the stand going, like, with her hand kind of in a slicing motion across her neck, like, cut it off, cut it off. Now they'll have to enter that in that way. But you could tell that was not supposed to be played. So the next recording, this is the last recording, y'all. This is what they ended on. And I thought it was an interesting thing to end it on because, well, we'll talk about it when we're done. August 24th, 4 o'clock p.m., George to Angela. George tells Angela about a property that he's found. He says, I think I might have found us a place. It's 255 acres, a house. It's a house. It has a barn, a garage, and a fence, and a mile-long driveway. And it's got ponds on it with bass and crappie and catfish, and they're all stocked. They want $400,000 for it, and I'm okay with giving him that. It's 5,000 miles from one side of the country to the other. And he talks about having to build some kind of a thing so the kids can't go like up the mountain or something. And Angela says they'll have to build some kind of a gate so people also couldn't get in from the other side. That was pretty much the last discussion. And I know it kind of shows maybe a plan to leave again or maybe to show that they're getting away with it too. But on the other hand, I'm looking at this as a juror, right? I always say that. Okay. So again, I'm not trying to be sympathetic at all because I'm not, but juries make me super nervous. And so all it takes is one person to feel a little bit sorry for George and feel like, yeah, I mean, out of all of them, he really, you know what I mean, y'all. But it almost sounded like a kid dreaming, kind of like just getting away from all the hoopla that they created and they, you know, totally chose to do this. I just thought it was an interesting recording to end on. I would have probably ended on one more angry with George. The last few with George were a little more of a softer side of George compared to what we've heard the last few days. So I thought that was interesting. But I think given what little actual evidence they had against George, I think overall the prosecution probably did the best. They did the best they could, y'all. We knew this was a weak case against him. And I don't think he'll get away with it. But I'm always nervous until that jury comes back. Because if you follow Casey Anthony, you know it can seem like a slam dunk. And then the jury comes back and you're like, what? So same with OJ. So that's just juries are unpredictable. And you never know the personal experiences of one single juror on that panel and how they may relate to a teeny tiny part of George that you might never relate to. It just common experiences or things like that. But I do think the prosecution has done as good as they could. There just wasn't much forensics or DNA to work with to implicate George. So essentially you rely on the testimony of his brother and his mom and these tapes that show a totally different, very angry side of George threatening law enforcement. That's going to be a big deal because, you know, it's, it was clear he was angry and ranting, but at the same time to even go there. And look, it's no question that George is part of that family. They worked as a unit. There's no reason to think he was oblivious to all this for months and months and months and didn't know until the day after. So I hope they put him under the jail. To be honest, 100%, I am rooting for it. The defense will start Monday, but there was some direct. They recovered the bug detector that was bought. The Winter Soldier mask was not collected the day of the search warrant. As far as Julia knew, George did not own a motorcycle in April of 2016. Julia pulls out an insurance fraud list. I think it's like a database, almost like CODIS for DNA or something, where you can pull up a list of like the fraud cases against somebody. Then she posts this, which is the wolf picture, the profile picture that George had and the comment posted. Now, here's the thing, it actually didn't come in, I don't think. There was an objection to this, went to sidebar, and then I think Parker was up. But I'll put this in the link. You can see it for yourself. It's a wolf that has like a scar over its eye, and Angela Wagner posted, "Really?" And George replied, "What? Don't like it?" So on Cross, Parker asked about the links that we heard compared to what they actually, you know, 24 hours in a day, we heard tiny snippets of things. And she said, you know, there were long periods of silence because one of them was sleeping. There was just long periods of silence in general. And the defense asked if the devices were accessed by a phone call. And yeah, they were. It was kind of that call-in system. So he said there were conversations you didn't record. And she's like, obviously. Parker said, there's 24 hours in a day. How many hours did you call? And she says, I'm not a truck monitor. And he said, oh, so you're testifying to other people's jobs. I'm not sure why he really picks on Julia. But man, I mean, he was just nasty to her today. And it's not a good look for the jury. If you're trying to get your client off, you don't badger or be super, super rude to the one witness that has been up there pretty much the most out of anybody and who seems like a real sweetheart. It's a bad look, and it made me uncomfortable to watch. And you could tell she was either about ready to spit in his eye or cry. Bless her heart, Julia. Like, you deserve an award, sister friend. And then he says, you're aware Jake testified he burned clothes. And she said, I didn't watch the proceedings. I wasn't allowed to as a witness. He asked if you're aware of his proffer, and he said he burned his clothes. At this point, he's being a real jerk, y'all. This is where it gets really jerky. And then, are you familiar with what Jake said about the clothing used in the murders? And she said, you have to be more specific. Like, she kind of starts throwing it back, because after a while, Julia does that. She'll kind of throw it back at him. And so she said, Jake said, what could have been burned, they burned. So on recross, Prosecutor Canepa comes back up, tries to do a little damage control, but then here comes Parker again. You determine what was relevant to the prosecution. She said, there was a team of us in preparation for this trial. So he said, but it was relevant to you as you determined to what would be used to convict George. She says, as part of the state, and then he just walks away, turns his back to her, and says, no further questions, Your Honor. And I was just like, what the heck? Like, way to send the jury home on a long weekend, by the way. And the last thing I'm thinking about is how this knucklehead treated Julia. Anyways, that's it, y'all. Almost an hour. Wow. These were not super easy. Again, George is very hard to understand sometimes. He's just very hard. He's high-pitched, and he talks really, really fast. And so anyways, I hope I got it mostly right. I listened a lot. So we will see you tomorrow for some updates in the other cases. If you want to follow along, please tune in. I know most of you here are for this case, but would love it if you stick around for other stuff. Be doing the same thing in January for the Alec Murdaugh case. Can't wait for that one. It's going to be huge. All right. We'll see you tomorrow. Have a good night.